Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? I hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, welcome to a magazine edition on the Kilt-Man channel. You know the drill. We just yakety-yak on and we go all around the houses, all around the world, plucking little stories, little snippets of interest from here, there, and everywhere. We talk about the things that have happened, the things that are happening, and the things that may yet still happen. And the idea is, you get yourself your favourite tipple. I'll be honest, that's not exactly my favourite tipple, but it's of the same family of my favourite tipple. It's whiskey, of course. So get yourself a drink. It can be whiskey, beer, it can be Ginzano. Apparently it's making a comeback. So I've heard Ginzano and baby sham, what? It could be a cup of tea, cup of coffee, it could be anything, a glass of water, some orange juice, some herbal tea, whatever floats your boat. Cheers, y'all. Current music playing at the moment is John Williams' score for Close Encounters of the Third Kind, which does have some bearing on one of our topics in today's edition. But first of all, just want to give a wee update on that Australian researcher from Casey Outpost, who was rescued in that bizarre, so mysteriously, misleadingly worded headline news about this guy who'd fallen stricken ill with some mysterious malady that had to be evacuated from Outpost Casey in Antarctica. And they couldn't fly all the way out there, but from Tasmania they set forth with the RSV Nuriana or something like that. I did report on all this, and it's an icebreaker. And they got through there, and they had to finally, they came to rest 89 miles away from Casey Outpost, and then sent their two helicopters out to go and pick this unnamed researcher, expeditioner, that they've called him, expeditioner. That's a strange word. I still don't think that word actually exists. Someone will correct me on that. Unnamed, and they haven't said what his developing medical condition actually was or is, because he's now been rescued. They flew him back to the RSV. They went back to Hobart, and he's in Royal Hobart Hospital with a specialised team of experts working on him even as we speak. He's alive and still unnamed, and he still haven't said what his malady was, his illness, his developing medical condition. And I did talk about, you know, everyone was saying to me, it's the thing, it's Antarctica. What they found in the ice? And an alien organism has got all of his flesh, and now he's patient X, he's gonna take over the world. Well, that may still happen, I don't know, because they're not divulging anything at all. Just that he's under the careful watch and care of a specialised medical team. We wish him well. So that's all I can give you on that, because I've been looking and been nothing further. So anyway, what else is in the news? There's loads. Now, first of all, I want to say, you know, Jesus Christ, look what's happened to Libya. In the wake of Storm Daniel, which swept across the Mediterranean and the Middle East and North Africa. Wow. Literally biblical flooding took place in Libya. Now, the thing about this is Libya is in two factions, possibly more, but there's a civil war raging in Libya since deposing Gaddafi. And what a way to be deposed as well. Found in a gutter and then sodomised with your own golden automatic pistol. And then beaten to death and then shot to bits by a mob. How the mighty fall, hey. But they got a unified government with two different parties in Libya who, even though they were going to bring the nation together, they couldn't agree on how to do it. So they ended up fighting. Such is life in the Middle East. It's all very tribalized, you know, and there's no, you'll never change that. It's been like that since day one, like in so many Middle Eastern states, countries, regions, and in Africa and across Europe as well. You get this. So, you know, civil war, things aren't going too well, and then Storm Daniel hits with enormous amounts of rainfall, which flood rivers and ripped asunder two huge dams, which took out entire towns and swept them out to sea. The before and after pictures of some of these regions are just truly jaw-dropping. You'd see like, I'm not going to call it like a metropolis, but a heavily built-up suburb. Lots of tenement buildings and traffic and stuff, life taking place. And that was like an hour before, an hour afterwards, nothing. So I don't know what the estimate is now, but it's something like at least 250,000 people have lost their lives. And there's a further 5,000 people missing. They're just putting bodies into mass graves because they're very quick off the mark in that neck of the woods. Someone dies, they're buried the next day. It's as simple as, especially in disasters like this, because you can't have bodies floating around and diseases and pestilence. But because a lot of this is in the region where they're not interacting, they're not helping each other. So international aid is having problems getting through. You would think that in situations of dire extremes, that an olive branch, albeit temporarily, will be extended. Look, between the two main factions. Look, we don't get along, but for the sake of humanity, we're going to have to work together to get this sorted. And in the midst of that, something good could come of it. But that's not what happens, because what will happen there, sadly, despite international aid and the recognised leader of Libya, who's not recognised by probably half the country, but he's recognised by international states and every other government in the world, they'll bend over backwards, they'll give a bit of leeway here to help rescue missions go in, they'll help with that, they'll send some aid. But into that void afterwards, when it stops being in the news, then the fighting will resume and ground that was gained by, we'll give you this because we're trying to help you out, they'll keep hold of that ground and then make inroads further on. It won't repatriate anybody, it won't bring peace. You think sometimes out of calamity, peace can happen, but it's not going to happen there. But just thought I'd mention that, because that's big, big news at the moment. Especially in the UK, we're reporting on that all the time. And the catastrophic figure of victims and deaths just goes up and up and up and up. And it's you can't even calculate that sort of thing. When there's thousands of people missing, they're not going to be found alive, are they? Because that force of water just drove everything out to sea. Jesus, not good. Anyway, good luck in Libya. And I mean that. Because you're going to need it. So, what's next in the news? Well, there's something pretty big. Sorry, I must refer to my notes. Well, this is the biggie. This is the one. Alien bodies. Now, I knew about this about 2-3 days ago, and it was going to report on it, but I was waiting to do it in this particular edition, which I'll say right now, this edition was due out yesterday. But, you know, real life gets in the way. It never happened. So I'm doing it now. And apparently I'm on borrowed time as well. So I'm going to try to wrap this up quite quickly. No 2.5 hour long marathon this time, he says. But anyway, this news broke and I thought I could talk about this. This is amazing. And it is, and it isn't at the same time. Alien bodies found. Yes, they were found a while ago and they were found in algae mines where they reckon they're 1,000 years old. Two bodies, both 2 feet tall, with two arms, two legs, an alien. There's an alien there. There's one over there somewhere as well. They've got the short, from the bottom jaw to the top of the head. That's very short. But the head itself, from front to back, is really long. Banana shaped, like the xenomorphs. Who'd have thought? But they're only two feet in stature. And they've got 3 fingers and 3 toes. And otherwise, the same sort of, the bigger eyes, but they're fossilized. Some people say they're mummified, they're fossilized. They've been preserved in this algae. There's another word for it. I wrote this down somewhere. Where are these caves? Diatom or algae mines. So they were found, they were carbon dated to be 1,000 years old. One, using x-rays, they have discovered has eggs inside it. I kid you not, this is what they've said. Eggs inside it. Now, but when you read it, it's eggs in quotation marks, kind of like, well, we don't know what else they are. We're going to call them eggs because they look like eggs. I don't know. But they're 2 feet, 2 feet tall, these things. Now, the reason why this has come to the news is because, what's his name? He's a journalist and ufologist. And his name is Mr. Jean Mossan. I'm not sure where he's from, but working with American ufologists and that, and scientists from Mexico and Peru and elsewhere, they did all their research on these things and then presented them to the Mexican government and US officials in the last couple of days. They presented them in glass window boxes so that everyone could observe them, and they presented all the information and knowledge that they knew. They have said that these are not the results of a crash. We hear about this all the time, like, you know, Area 51 has, you know, the Hangar 18 or whatever. All of these bases have, you know, crashed, retrieved UFO crashed vehicles and sometimes bodies, and they're, you know, using back engineering to work out how these things fly, and we adapt that technology. If you ask me, they've been working with aliens since DOS. Look at the pyramids, for God's sake, you know, or for Pharaoh's sake. And so this ain't exactly news, but because it's, you could have noticed now that even mainstream news programs and reporters and magazine shows on TV have elements of this now. Aliens that, UFOs this. Now, whereas they used to snigger when he said all this sort of thing, and it would be sort of the tail end of the show. Oh, and in lighter news, someone in Oregon thought they saw a UFO, you know, and they laugh and joke about it. They don't do that now. They don't do it now because it's now got it's reached the stage of sort of importance and relevance and credibility, because, you know, the US government has for the last couple of years been drip feeding stuff, and like, yeah, we're going to do a study on this, and now they've got this the US Department of Defense has its own UFO website. It's the one-stop shop. You go to that to find out everything, all the latest news and developments. You go there. That's official. That opened this week, I think. And so, you know, they're taking it seriously. You had the hearings for Congress in the States. The whistleblower from the Department of Defense, Grosch. I always get this guy's name wrong. One day I'll write it down. But anyway. And two other guys, high-ranking officials from the US military, who've had eyes on and encounters. But this guy knows, this whistleblower knows a lot. They were grilled for hours and hours and hours, and it was televised, and we saw all of that. And it was great. It was a massive step forward in disclosure. And in September, we're now in September, there's another hearing with other witnesses coming forward. Now, this one I don't think will be televised, or only bits of it will, because this is much more highly secure information. Yeah, you may go, oh, so we're never going to know, are we? Well, it's baby steps, isn't it? We've known about this all our lives. They've known about it since before we were born. And only now, with the mounting pressure of people who've got camera phones, and they zip and zap all these things taking place, And they go on things like YouTube. There's such an overwhelming amount, a deluge of almost Libyan flood proportions of people that are speaking out. Well, US government can't combat that. Not everyone is lying. There's definitely a lot of truth out there. So they're now really, well, we've got to do this now. And maybe the time is right. But they're going to do it in a procedural fashion. We'll do this, then we'll do that, we'll debunk this, but we're putting it into public consciousness. That's what the effect is. So you're seeing it more and more and more on sort of mass media, mainstream TV and radio, and you know, wherever you get your broadcasts from. It's mentioned all the time and it's not scoffed at. So, and some of these stories are getting real, you know, headline news. Well, you're getting it all the time, on this especially. So, you know, they're sort of paving the way that, yeah, the big bombshell is going to be dropped. And it won't come from any terrestrial air force. It's from up there, you know, outer regions. So these bodies, they are not retrieved from a crash site. They haven't said, to my knowledge, you know, why they think they were found, where they were found, and why they were there. But that's why they've preserved, this algae mine is preserved. And some say mummified, they're fossilized. And they are freaky looking things, without a doubt. No offense if any of the still living members are out there, you know, watching this. Loving your work. Loving the movies. Cheers, y'all. But there are people who are saying, oh, this is ridiculous, it's fake. They've not been proved to be fake at all. And these people, this Jean Moussan, and all the experts who were giving the evidence, were doing it under oath, like the guys who were talking to Congress in America. It's under oath. If they're lying, they get sent to prison. So, you know, you don't just make this shit up and then go on the world stage and talk about it. Think about Mexico. Mexico is a hotbed of UFO activity. Always has been. For many, many years, people have said, look, we're used to it. Like Mexico and Brazil as well. You know, they just walk out onto the streets and look up in the afternoon sky, and there's fleets going over. There's tons and tons of videos of this. And they can't all be fake. I really don't believe that they're all fake. But the Mexican government's kind of like been, well, yeah, we accept it. It's been going on. Can't deny it. It's there. It's just the US and the Western powers, and a lot of Eastern powers, who are like, well, no, we know more about this than you think we do. So, but we've got to keep quiet, because we've got to keep the world order, you know, under control. Because when we unleash everything, it'll be too much for human minds to accept. What do they take us for? We're not idiots, you know. Just tell us. Introduce some of your friends, your comrades, your little but big-headed comrades, you know, who've been pulling some strings and watching from afar, but like, from their bases on the dark side of the moon. Look, I do believe, I don't care what you think about me saying that, but I've never denied it. I do believe, and there's got to be something out there. I think there's something here as well. And I think we haven't explored the oceans. The oceans are the key to where these things are probably hiding. You know, if you think about it, they can't just zip off again to, you know, I don't know, the Osiris constellation in the middle of fucking Timbuk, Cosmic 2. I don't know. If you've got bases underwater, then there you go. Bases in Antarctica, apparently. Well, that's tied in, hasn't it? But I've seen the imagery of these bodies, and you know, you're not blown away by this. You've seen this sort of thing before. One was found a good while ago, and they said, again, looked alien, but other experts said, no, that's a deformed child. So it's not alien, it's not extraterrestrial. And these same debunkers, and who's to say that they might be right, because this might not be true, but these things do not look humanoid. Well, they are humanoid, but they're definitely not humans, if you know what I mean. Those heads are a bit wacky, and the actual, and three fingers, three toes, and I don't know. But checking out, you know, the imagery, and I think there's video footage as well, and it's well documented, and it's been on every news program today. I was going to do this video yesterday, as I say, I was going to talk about this, but I didn't do it because of other things. The pub, you know what I'm like. And woke up this morning, we have a radio clock alarm that comes on. It doesn't blast out an alarm call, it just comes on with the radio. So you wake up to bloody voices. And they were talking about this, and I went, I woke up and I wanted to do this bloody video. I wanted to talk about this before it hit the UK mainstream. Shit. Anyway, it has. Check it out and let me know what you think. Are they real? Let's face it, you don't know they're real. I don't know they're real. I like to believe and want to believe that they're real. And if experts are telling me this, this, and this, and that gets corroborated by other experts, then okay, I'm on board. But if two people say, like, no, it's bullshit, they're actually, because I think some of these debunkers, these other historians are sort of like, well, no, certain rituals back in the ancient days of Mexico, well, Peru, these were found in Cusco in Peru, that's where they were found. And then obviously studied and brought in these glass sarcophagi to the Mexican government and revealed. So if they tell me about the rituals, certain children had religious ceremonies to go through where they would wrap up their heads with like scarves and binds and change the shape of their heads. But you're not gonna make a big fucking banana out of it, are you? You know, like, it's a little tiny face and then a big long head, you know. What kind of binding would do that to a human skull? I don't think so, somehow, do you? But if they are fake, then you've got a lot of people who are under oath. Now, this is under oath in Mexico. One of the most corrupt countries that there's ever been. So, does it really mean anything at all? You know, under oath, in the eyes of God and all that. I don't know. Does it? It's different in America, and it'd be different in this country as well, and many other Western countries. But Mexico, I don't mean to pour scorn there, but you haven't got the greatest track record of law and order and justice and governmental integrity, shall we say. As usual. So let me know what you think about that. That's going to be an ongoing thing. And again, it's another one of these breadcrumbs. I think this is bigger than a breadcrumb. This is like almost an entire loaf been thrown at you. Have that! Alien bodies, there you go. We all have the alien autopsy thing, supposedly from Roswell and crash site victims. That was debunked massively, although there's still a huge core contingent of people who believe in that. I think that was fake, I'll be honest. But I do believe that, yeah, you could come all this bloody way using black holes and warped space-time, and you get here and you crash. Well, thing is, I believe in that, because if human beings are so stupidly fallible as well, that they might have the big brains and super technology, but they can still fuck up on a really super primal level. Everyone is prone to this. Even the Krell in the awesome, fantastic planet, forbidden planet, not fantastic planet. They discover the technology to meld all their minds and read people's minds, so they have machines do everything for them, and they can live a life of high spiritual luxury. But they unleash the power of the id, the subconscious. So subconscious thoughts, desires, lusts, hatreds, jealousies manifest themselves, and in one night of catastrophic horror, the entire civilization of the hugely knowledgeable Krell destroy themselves. So, you know, even the higher intelligences can still screw up on a really fundamental level by forgetting about the monsters of the id. Right, what's next? But I do love this story. I'm sure we're going to talk more about this. Well, we had a jailbreak in the UK. Wandsworth Prison, a Category B prison, was housing a terror suspect called Daniel Caliph. He's ex-Royal Signals. Yeah, he's a British soldier. and he was serving time. Well, he was on remand. He hadn't actually been formally tried for his crimes. His crimes were leaving fake bombs at military bases. And also, this has been kind of suppressed in the last few days, that he was also giving information to Iran, or if you're an American, Iran. And that's spying, that's espionage. So that was it. He's very young as well. He was incarcerated on remand in Wandsworth Prison. And now, this is last week. He was working in the kitchens, in a chef's outfit and all that. He escaped. He tied himself onto the underside of a delivery van and got out. He had a bag of change of clothes with him. And he picked up a bike at some point. Oh, he was on the run for 75 hours. And this was huge news. But the weird thing was, it was never taken seriously. You know, we say about the UFOs and all that kind of stuff, and like, oh, newscasters and presenters would like, they kind of scoff and snigger. Well, they were doing that about this guy being on the run. You know, he's a terror suspect, but really, is he that? He can't be that bad. They put him in a category B prison, which is not where terror suspects would normally go. And he's working in the kitchen, and he's allowed to get out. Let's just break that down. By the way, he was caught, but we'll come on to that. Let's just break it down. He's working in the kitchen, he's in a chef's outfit. Somehow or other, he manages to get out to the yard where a delivery van is and tie himself onto the underside of this van. It reminds me of, remember in Martin Scorsese's remake of Cape Fear with Robert De Niro as Max Cady? Well, Max straps himself to the underside of Nick Nolte and family's car. And he's in tree bark camouflage as well, which is, you don't see that very often, not in movies anyway. And you don't see it in the woods either, because you can't see the wood for the trees and the tree bark camouflage. But it reminded me of that. So he's gone on the underside and travelled out. So within hours, like, he could have left the country. You know, and they were doing extra checks at all airports and train stations and everywhere. Like, and he was sighted abroad. Sighted in France a couple of times. He was sighted in Scotland. He was sighted in Wales. He was sighted fucking everywhere. And even little aliens in Peru were going, they were phoning home and said, I've seen that escaped convict. He's here by the Aztec pyramids, you know. And clearly someone helped him get out. And someone turned a blind eye to a truck leaving Wandsworth Prison. Don't they have those little, you know, on the sort of, the pole with a mirror underneath. Didn't they have a little look underneath there? No, apparently not. Christ, even when they try to escape from Stalag Luft 3 in the Great Escape, you know, and they're all underneath trucks and in the hay bales, they're putting pitchforks through, you know. Someone helped him. Someone turned a blind eye and someone helped him out. Now, he was caught 75 hours later. Someone had seen him on the banks of a... was it canal? It's on the banks of a canal. Not wasn't the Thames. I could be wrong about that. But it was on the banks of a canal. Not far away. And a guy was jogging down and he saw the guy that looked like this escaped convict. It's lying on the banks. It's like that with his head in his hands, dreaming. And then he did a few miles and came back and the guy was still there. Well, that's odd. You know, just thought it looked seem weird. Anyway, all the people had seen him as well. Hiding in plain sight. Change of clothes. Wasn't wearing a chef's outfit with the big fucking souffle hats on, like. And a plainclothes copper got him. He was riding a bike. This is the escaped convict, not the copper. He was riding a bike and this plainclothes copper saw him and hauled him off the bike, made the arrest. And he's been videoed. He was sitting there handcuffed, laughing. He was always meant to be caught. He wasn't trying to get anywhere. This is a setup, folks. Oh, tinfoil hat again. No, think about this. He's on remand. He hasn't been charged with anything. And in the grand scheme of terrorism, a couple of fake bombs. They weren't real bombs. The whole thing's been, he's put in a prison like Wandsworth. Not known for its terror suspects being put in there, high profile. Okay, this thing about trafficking intelligence to Iran, that's been kind of quashed. Whether it's true or not, I don't know, because that was first talked about and then suddenly it seemed to just disappear. At least I've not heard that get mentioned in the days since. Cheers, Jean. And then laughing, hiding in plain sight and laughing. They thought, oh, there's someone on the outside who's helped him. Fucking clearly. He had a little bag with him as well, of a change of clothes, which is what, obviously, he wasn't riding around like Gordon Ramsay in a chef's outfit. And now he's going to go to the Old Bailey. He has been remanded in custody again, because what's he been charged with now? He's an escaped prisoner. You know, he's been on the run. Well, he's a British soldier as well. Or what a soldier's taught to do when they're captured, it is your duty to escape. Unless you're a fucking terror suspect intending you back on your own country, king and country and all that. Nah. So, you know, you won't make that one stick. But they are, that is your duty to escape. But this is weird on so many fronts. It's not taken seriously by anybody. Even Rishi Sunak, who was talking about it, you know. Yeah, Rishi Sunak. You don't see much of him these days, do you? He's our fucking Prime Minister, for Christ's sake. It was kind of like light-hearted about it. They went ramming home. They even said, look, the guy doesn't pose a threat to anybody. They said that. But even so, don't approach him. Just call the police when you see him. This whole thing is a setup. It's got to be. Someone did say about this is a movie in the making. It's like this guy, he's not going to get charged with much fake bombs and stuff like. Hasn't really done anything. They've arranged all this and he's got a few prison guards in on the act as well. Just turn a blind eye. I'll get myself caught and we'll make a movie out of this. And I'll be the advisor, a consultant. I'll make a fortune, but I'll share it with you guys. And the other, oh yeah, really. But when you analyse the way this actually happened, you think, you know what I mean? We're now in a culture where we question everything. Or rather, some of us do. Not enough of us do. There's still too many sheeple out there that just go along with what you get told. Because apparently now, you know, have you heard this? The new variant of COVID. Oh, has already struck again London in a tenement block, one isolated block. But suddenly it was like five cases. Then it's a rest home, isn't it? Let's get this straight. It was five cases. Then it became like 35 cases, and now they're, oh my God, this is so again on the radio. Only this morning, after the aliens, they were talking about, well, we could go back to wearing masks again. Would you wear a mask again? And they did a straw poll on the streets of Liverpool. This is local radio, obviously. And people kind of, well, you know, would you go back to lockdown? But we shouldn't go back to lockdown. But for every one person that says we shouldn't go back to lockdown or wear masks, there was three other people that said, I trust what the government says because COVID's very serious. Fuck off. Fuck off. Not having that shit again. Not going through all that bollocks, which is sheer bollocks. But now you can see, because we're transitioning from summertime into autumn. We've still got autumn to go, and yet all they're talking about is, oh, winter's on the way. All your gas bills, all your bills are going to go up again, your energy bills. So they're really fucking sledgehammers coming down. Can we just get through autumn and enjoy Halloween first before you ram home and destroy Christmas all over again? With another fake fucking pandemic. I remember the imagery of all the ambulances stacked up outside hospitals and people saying, oh, the dead are piled high. I live by a cemetery. I didn't see any further burials. All these multiple thousands who are dying every day. Do you really believe that? Fuck off. Don't give me that shit. I'm the one who's sitting here drinking, and I don't believe that bullshit at all. All those ambulances stacked outside. Any other day of the year you film it, even when they're on strike, all those ambulances are still there as well. So there wasn't any extra fucking ambulances on standby and ferrying bodies in, and they're treating them in ambulances. You couldn't see any of this. Oh, you can speak to some NHS expert on an emergency ward, but they wouldn't show you the corridor where all the bodies are piled up, because there weren't any bodies piled up. There weren't. There was more bodies mummified and fossilised in Peru from alien spaceships. So I'm not having that either. But you'll get that. This will be another big scaremongering tactic which you're going to get towards the end of the year. Although it's starting now. Okay. So Daniel Khalif. Yeah. he hid in plain sight and laughed when he was caught. Because he wasn't going anywhere. It was all part of a plan. He was meant to be captured. No one gave a toss. No one cared. There was little stupid stories like, maybe foreign powers have already got him out of the country. Why would he pick him? He was fucking inept by doing fake bombs in the first place and then got caught. Or does the conspiracy go back even further? Was he always earmarked for this? And if you look at him, if you look at his face, the Rugby World Cup is on at the moment, and there is an Italian player, and I forgot his name, who is a dead ringer. Now, when the World Cup's kicked off the weekend, this guy was still on the run. And I was watching, I love the rugby. And the lineup for the Italian team came on. And I went, shit, that's him. That's him. I wish I knew the guy's name now. Oh, God. But my God, if you put Daniel Khalif's face next to this guy's face, they're even the same age. You know, they look identical. It's like, is no one else spotting this? That the escaped prisoner is now playing fucking World Cup rugby for Italy. It's just bizarre, isn't it? Right. Okay, we've done two major stories there. Well, three if you count Libya as well. Four if you count the up-and-coming pandemic. The up-and-coming pandemic of scaremongering and bullshittery. Okay, now this one isn't good. Because the other ones were actually, you know, they were light-hearted, weren't they? XL bullies are dogs. And they are a breed of American staff and pit bull, which were created in the early 1980s. And then were crossbred with other dogs to create a really muscular, prehistoric bastard of a dog. I know lots of these dogs and all the other variants, and my dog Husky loves them all, and they all love her, and they have a wild time together. Now problem is the music's getting too fucking boisterous. Down you go, Mr. Williams. I doff my cap to you, sir, the maestro. These dogs are exceptionally vicious. They can be. They're bred to be fighters. They chase prey and they lock on with the pressure of a fucking land-based great white shark. You cannot dislodge them. You can't. And I think 75%, I'm not kidding you, 75% of attacks, and attacks in this country, dog attacks, have gone up in the last few years. And 75% of them are down to this particular breed, the XL Bully. And it's knobheads who get them. Drug gangs, scumbags from the streets, villains who have them because they're fighting dogs. They are built like dinosaurs. Little squat fucking dinosaurs with heads that are like a Terminator's head. You can punch it, shoot it, stab it. But with one bit of difference, they are impervious. And when they lock on, they shred nerves, muscle, and they go for the throat, they go for the groin. They're fighting, they're bred and created as fighting dogs. So we had another incident. After having had many incidents, 75% of dog attacks, and there's been a huge uptick in dog attacks because of these dickheads who have them. dickheads who unleash them on other dogs to cause trouble, just for fun, who can't control them and they break out of people's houses and they have them live in the garden and they leap over people's hedges and fences and gates and attack people on the streets. Then a dog, it takes 10 people to subdue these beasts and then they've got to be put down. Now, this is the thing. Suella Braverman, Home Secretary, after the, there was an attack at the weekend in Birmingham where an 11-year-old girl, don't worry, the footage is all out there and it is shocking, but the girl survived and she's actually okay. It could have been far worse. So many kids get mauled to death. And a man, age not too sure of, was attacked. But this dog, it's all caught on camera, attacks her, then goes on a massive rampage around a garage and attacks various people, but goes after one guy in particular. It's on his elbow, it's on his shoulder, it jumps up. They're fucking hitting it with chairs and all sorts. Like, it's horrible, frightening footage. So after that attack, this seems to be the straw that's broken the camel's back. Suella Braverman and Rishi Sunak. Again, he's had more mentionings in this video than ever before. He's about the size of one of his aliens as well. Now, he always thought the politicians weren't human. Da-da-da-da, Rishi. So they should ban these dogs. And the public has backed this. And, we'll talk about this a little bit. Because being a dog owner, a responsible dog owner, of a husky. Huskies are not renowned for violence. They're very, very loyal, very playful, very mischievous. But they love people. Love people. They're the most... I've had dogs all my life. I've had German Shepherds all my life. But the husky, I say right now, hand on heart, and I know many of them because she joined a group of sled dogs and became one of the leading members of the dog pack. And we'd all walk these dogs, all huskies and malamutes. And they're great. They're such the friendliest, most sociable animals I've ever encountered. It's to a fault as well, because they'll put themselves in danger, you know, by going to these big prehistoric bastards. Like, and of course, my dog loves all these. She knows plenty of them. I'm not naming any names, but I know a few of these dogs around here. And in my experience, they've been fantastic, and their owners are very responsible. They're not a problem. The problem is the irresponsible owners who haven't got a clue what they're doing, and they've got this dog for protection, for status. They go around the estate, look at my fucking monster on a lead. If I fucking unclip this, like, you're fucking dead. I'll fucking shred you in a fucking second, you bastard. You know, and I'll have your fucking bollocks above the fireplace as a fucking trophy. There are people like that, and they're the ones who breed these dogs, who buy these dogs, who unleash these dogs, who can't control them, and then small kids get hurt. People get hurt. Everyone can get hurt. These dogs are brutes. Now, the outcry is to ban them outright. Well, there's been a huge outcry. The public has gone, because they do all these polls, don't they? And everyone has gone like, yep, should be banned. Ban the breed. In this country right now, as of 1991, the Dangerous Dogs Act, there are 4 banned breeds. The American Pit Bull, the Japanese Tosa, the Dogo Argentinos, and the Fila Brasileiro. I can't read my own writing, which ties into another segment coming up in a bit. The Fila Brasileiro. Now, if you look at pictures of these dogs, they all look the same. They're all these little scunt fuckers. They've got just I've got these fucking big jaws, but I've got a little fat fucking but muscular, powerful body. They are grizzly bears which have been shrunk down in size, and they are complete bastards, or can be. They have the propensity to be complete and utter ruthless, dangerous bastards. But banning the breed isn't the answer. Every dog is individual. But the RSPCA and many, many dog experts and behavioural experts have come out the last few days and said, look, no, you can't ban them. Because if you do that, then suddenly they'll start crossbreeding other animals and they'll create another one. And then you have to do that. And then you're going to work on maybe it's certain size and weight. You know, so dogs over a certain size and weight will have to be banned as well. Banned. If you've got those dogs, they'll be taken from you and put down. That's what it means as well. Now, there are probably thousands of these dogs, these XL bullies, that are beautiful animals. As I say, I know several. And they play with kids, they're fantastic with kids, they're super loyal, super highly trained, and so doting. They've not been abused. However, they have got this in their DNA because it's been bred into them to do this. So, and they could turn at any moment. Any dog could turn at any moment. Any dog. A fucking Pekingese, a Chihuahua. And they're the fucking worst. Because they'll nip you on the Achilles tendon. Little twats. You know. But, no dog should be arbitrarily banned and destroyed, I don't think. And I mean this. When you have gangs of scallies and complete and utter street mongrels of the human variety, and I use human very loosely there, who will genuinely kick someone to death and have fun doing it and film it, and then piss on the body while they're still alive, and then burn them, which happens. And, but you don't put them down, do you? When they've actually gone out together, and let's just do this for fun. And they do it, and it happens a lot. I'm sorry, folks, it does. And believe it or not, worse things. And the thing is, they film it all now. But when they get caught, if they get caught, they'll be sent to, they go on remand. Then they go to prison. Then they'll be rehabilitated. They'll be looked after. They'll be fed. They'll be treated. And no. They're just as much a victim of society and their upbringing. It's not their fault. A dog does it. That's it. You'll put down. Dog didn't do it for fun. The dog did it because it was trained to do it in the first place, beaten and abused to do it. Or it was frightened and, reacted a certain way. But that's a dog's nature. You know, a little kid goes and sticks his finger up a dog's bum or squeezes its testicles. You know, what's the fucking dog going to do? It can't say, oh, please stop that. I don't like that. And the thing is, dogs actually do. They go they move away and they're telling you, but some kids persist, and then sadly things go worse. But again, so the dog gets put down. Fucking hell, the dog was the one that was abused, the dog was the one that was a victim. These street cunts go out there and do this on purpose, and they're allowed to live. That's wrong. That's wrong in my opinion, that's completely and utterly wrong. So my argument now is XL bullies are dangerous. They are fundamentally inbred DNA dangerous. So you've got to find out who's got them. You've got to get them registered. And most responsible owners will concur with this. Get them muzzled. Get them chipped. Get them muzzled. That's it. You can't really arbitrarily ban another dog. It's very difficult to do so as well. You've got to go through a lot of hurdles and hoops of fire and stuff like that because a lot of outcry comes in. And there are fantastic owners of these breeds out there who are totally on board with us. They don't want to hurt anyone and they're responsible. But it's, again, you'll never stop the irresponsible ones, the scumbags who use these as a status symbol and, they're a weapon at their disposal, as well as the knife and the Desert Eagle or the Glock 19 that they're using these days. You're not going to stop that by banning a dog. They're still going to find another way of doing it. They're breeding them illegally. They're keeping them, illegally, and their use of them is illegal as well. So. But it is a truly scary thing. By the way, you know, you get attacked by one of these things, or any dog for that matter, it's easier for a male to survive and to take control of a situation, because women and girls have usually have higher pitched voices, and screaming and running are the two things which is going to attract this dog all the more, because they're bred to fight and to take down. If you run, they're going to go after you. So, and I know, look, a monster thing like this comes at you, what are you going to do? You know, and my words will mean nothing. You've got to be trained how to do this. And hello, did some dog fighting training, not fighting dogs together, how to escape, evade, and if you're cornered by a dog, how to get out of it, especially if it's an attack dog. So we did some stuff, but some things I can't go into here. But what you do, if you're a bloke, or if you're anyone, you should stand tall and become more imperious to that in stature, to that dog. Shout at it, but a male voice works because it's lower, you know. So if you can do that, then brilliant. You could stop it. Put a hand out. A lot of dogs respond to that. Even dogs who aren't trained, because they're like, what the? Some dogs will go for it. That, in a way, like someone coming out with a knife, and you're boxed in, you've got no way out. You've got to offer something, offer them a hand. So the knife comes at you, you put your hand out. That knife could penetrate right through your hand. But the thing is, adrenaline kicks in, you've got them. Your hand will still work, by the way. It'll still work. It goes right away through. It'll still work. You're in problems if it's gone through here, and you've got that, you've disarmed them, and then you can do whatever the fucking hell you want, you know, and destroy them. But you're going to have to sacrifice something to survive. And the same thing with a dog attack. You may have to. You always see them, they offer the arm, you know, they offer the forearm, it clamps onto that. And then you can swing the bastard around, you can do whatever you want, you can get it onto the deck, and you can make a wish. Whoosh. And that thing about don't let kids put their finger up a dog's bum hole. Well, don't. But in a situation like this, you go for its fucking bits. It's going for your bits. They go for the throat, they go for the stomach, and they go for the groin. And all the hot spots, like the juicy bits. So you go for its juicy bits, and you go for its eyes. One of these dogs, when it clamps on, you're not going to get that. You can punch, kick, shit out of it, but it's not going to let go of you. It will not let go. It's designed that way. It's just... You better lock jaw, which is like a disease, but it's like it fucking will, like tetanus can give you a lock jaw. Once they're locked on, that's it. And that amount of pressure, you're going to have to kill it. You're going to have to kill it. You gouge its eyes out and you push even deeper in and you rip its bollocks off. Or if it's a female, you shove your hand right inside and you just rip everything out. That dog's going to go. Now, what a gloriously happy topic, killing dogs. I don't want to kill any dog. I love all dogs. I love them all. But I'm not stupid. And these things are animals. And animals act certain ways. And if suddenly that primal switch goes over and they see you as prey, which, you know, it's what happens when these incidents take place. If you can't get away from it, if you can't thwart it in its attack, you can't take the situation down and diffuse it and scare it off, which you can do by your power, your voice, and your stature. And don't run. But you try telling a small young girl, don't run when a dog chases you. Not going to happen, is it? And that's the worst thing. You're just leading it on. It just thinks you're prey. Is you get onto the floor and you curl into a fetal ball and you protect your groin, you protect your stomach, you protect your throat, you tuck your head in, keep your face down, try and put an arm over your face. It'll worry you, it'll attack, it might bite, it might do a lot of damage. But, you know, hopefully as time goes on, people have come in to help you. Or the dog's got bored and just gone away. Incident, it's the same thing with any predatory animal when it attacks you. Grizzly bears, grizzly bears. The same fucking thing with the grizzly bear. You know, fucking 3,000 pounds, 10 feet tall, and it's standing up, and a grizzly bear takes you down. And they go for the head, you know. They go for the head and the groin, grizzly bears. They take the skull apart, take the brains out. Ooh. But, so, you know, same thing with a grizzly bear as well. Same thing, and you shelter yourself. Grizzly bears are massively more known to, like, well, they could throw you around, they could take an arm, I know, they can do all that, and they have done. But people who do that manoeuvre and kill into a ball, it might knock them around a bit, kick them around a bit, give them a good sniff, sit and watch them for a bit. But hopefully in the meantime, people have intervened and scared it off, or it will get bored and walk away. Now, you could be in a bad state. You know, you're not going to come out going like, oh, gee heck, that was a wee escapade. And slap your thigh, you know. Not really. I'm conscious of the fact I've got to move on with this because there's things happening and I've got to box clever here. So let me know what you think about that. Banning dogs, it may come to, if we get another horrific thing, like a baby's ripped apart in a pram, then there's nothing down for them. It's as simple as. But there's a lot of people out there who are worried now, who own these dogs, or own variants of these dogs. Because that's the other thing, there's a lot of these dogs out there which have been crossbred with other things. So, but it's all to make them more muscular, more adrenalized, with more, what's the word I'm looking for? Oh God. When you're running forever and you keep going, more, not intensity, whatever it is, I don't know. But just bigger, nastier brutes. But the people who are doing it want them to be killers. That's why they're doing it. So they're the ones, the law should come down on them. Should have got to this point a bit earlier. The law, the dogs are, they're victims. Okay, if your daughter gets savaged by one of these, you're going to kill that dog yourself. I know, I'd be exactly the same. I'll find that dog and I'll kill it. But I'll also go and kill all the people that owned it and everyone that bred it, and I'll kill the entire bloodline. But that's just me, you know. But that's a personal thing. But in reality, you come down heavy on the people that are breeding these, which is what famously our justice system in this country doesn't bother doing that. They don't go to the root cause of what causes the social problems. They just put a band-aid and slap the wrists of mainly the victims. And a lot of innocent people get caught up in this. The actual root cause, societal issue, they don't ever go to that and try and rectify that. Oh God, no. Because that's too much funding, too much investment, too much politics gets involved in it. Fuck off. Close Encounters. This is the, you know, we, the wild signals. Anyway, take down the people who are breeding these, the people that own them irresponsibly, the scumbags that have these dogs that are selling them to idiots, you know, take them down. Feed them to the dogs. Okay. Weirdo in the park. Right, now this is an incident that happened to me. I wasn't the weirdo in the park. Let me just say that right now. Now, I was walking the dog. This was, was it last weekend? Last Friday, I think it was. And I'm now on Thursday the following week. And I was in the cemetery, the Boneyard. Rake Lane Cemetery. My stamping ground. And there's many entrances to Rake Lane Cemetery, because it spans several main roads, so you've got ways in. And above the cemetery, you have Elston Gardens, which is a park with a library, Elston Library. Ah, oh, fabulous, fabulous place. and a kids' play area there. Lovely gardens, lots of trees. Now, you can go into that those gardens and go through into the cemetery. And there used to be two ways into that cemetery. You've also got allotments as well. People's allotments, their gardens, their, you know, they're growing vegetation and vegetables and stuff like that. And, but there is a gate which has been locked by Mr. Marquis, who oversees the cemetery. And he's a twat. And anyway, he locked this gate for various bogus reasons. But anyway, I was by that gate, and there's a tap of water there. So, you know, it's a hot day, so the dog was under the water, having a bath and drinking it. And incidentally, one of my family graves is right there as well. It's my dad's, I always get this wrong, my dad's uncle. Something like that. I don't know. But anyway, that's there. And it was an afternoon. It was sunny, very sunny, in fact. But that gate's sealed. Now, you can't get through that gate. That's important. Because what happened was, I could see through the railings, there's railings all the way around, that there was a strange man acting very bizarrely just on the other side of the railing. And he was in a huge area of trees, but he's looking down towards the kids' play area, swings and, you know, seesaws and all that kind of climbing frames down there. And I saw him and I thought, you know, you straight away know. I'm a trained observer anyway, so I spot people's behavior, and that does not look right. And, you know, even a blind person would have known this guy was up to no good. He was walking up and down, up and down, up and down. He was jittery, and he was hiding. Whenever there's paths in that park, Elsland Gardens, and from there's an entrance right by the kids' play area. And so where I'm looking, well, I'm looking at you, but sadly, you are now that guy. I'm looking at you as being that guy. And the railings are here, the dog is here. He's on the other side of the railings, and they're high railings as well. I can't get over these. Well, I can, but I'm not in the kilt. I'm not going to do it. And but straight away down this, you know, parallel to these railings, down there is the main entrance to the park from that street. And right next to that is the kids' play area. So he's here looking that way at the kids' play area. Now, when people walk around through the company loose entrances, and they walk like diagonally across the park, and they can go out to another street, or they can go into the cemetery at the other entrance. They go past all the allotments and through all the lovely park area. Every time someone was coming through, and I watched for a good 10 minutes, he hit behind a tree. In fact, the very first thing I thought when I saw him, I thought, is that guy having a piss behind a tree there? Because it looked like that. I'll be honest, I don't think he was. I think he was just hiding behind a tree as someone was going past. And then I began to watch him walk up and down. This is a guy right now. I can remember him. I took pictures. They come out really crap. It's like taking a picture of a Bigfoot. It just didn't work out. And he was sort of mid to late 30s, I would say. He had short dark hair, although he was bald on top. He had the hair just going around here. It was scruffy, possibly a bit of you know, grey in there as well. He had a very scruffy, unkempt but short beard. But it just looked scratchy, you know. And he wore a hooded top. The hood was down, but it was either a light green or a light brown. And he wore a pair of jeans, and he was walking up and down, walking up and down, walking up and down. And I thought, this is fucking wrong, this. So I stood there, and there's trees there. And I was wearing the Royal Stuart tartan. It's very bright, very red. And a little vest on as well, like, so I was like stood there resplendently Kilt-Man-ish with a husky who's kind of obvious as well, and he saw me, and he kind of stopped in his tracks, and he kind of muttered to himself, and he ran back to a tree. I watched. I thought, no, you're up to fucking no good at all. And I thought, is the kids down there? And I looked through the fence and I couldn't see any kids. There are other trees near me which were in the way, and I couldn't see anyone. Maybe there's no one there. Oh, he's just got, maybe he's just got problems. And this is the issue that I had. If he's just got problems and I'm thinking, you look threatening, you look intimidating, that's my problem. I shouldn't be doing that. So I was in this quandary. What do I do? Do I phone the police? Do I do this? Do I actually approach him? Do I shout at him? Do I do anything? Well, anyway, he clocked me again because I was still there. And he stopped and he stared at me. And I just stared at him. And then he ran. And he ran towards where the kids' play area is, but the main entrance. I thought he was running out. So the dog was just sitting there, minding their own business. And so I sort of ran parallel to him, but I can only go so far. I can't go through those gates because the gates are locked. And then it stops. There's people's back walls are there, so I can't go any further. And I thought, oh, well, he's gone at least. I've scared him off. He was up to no good. It didn't look good. Why would you run if you weren't doing anything wrong? So I then walked back. But the thing is, I stopped as he ran and I lost him. And looked back at the dog. The dog was like, Dad, where are you going? Dad. And I looked back at her. I went, oh, I'm coming back. Oh, I'm coming back on. So as I walked back, I realised the motherfucker, he doubled back. And when I stopped, I looked at the dog. He must have gone past me again. Trained observer, yeah. Fucking useless. He'd gone back and he's right back in his little patch, walking up and down again. And I thought, you fucking bastard. So I stared at him again and I'm thinking, my heart was like that now. I thought, I've got to phone the police. But I thought, who'd you phone? In this country, we phone 999 for an emergency, a life-threatening emergency. And you phone 101 if it's not life-threatening. But we've got a police station around the corner, Manor Road Police Station. And I thought, I must have that number in my phone somewhere. I must have. Regular viewers will know that I had an incident with the police planes, which are going overhead all the time and really pissing everybody off. Like, and then I phoned the police and I got through to the right department eventually. And they said, yeah, it is one of ours, yeah. And I had a right fucking ding-dong with them. It's pissing me off. What are you doing? And they said, oh, it's just training flights and all that. It's just routine. I've since learned a lot more about those police, National Air Force airplanes. And yeah, I kind of give them a bit of leeway now. But I thought, what do we do? Should we do a phone? Went on my phone, couldn't find the number. I thought, it's not an emergency. He's not done anything, has he? Really? And I've probably only made him even worse, more jittery. Another dog walker suddenly appeared. A little tiny dog he had, like, and he was dressed in like spandex as well, like, which is a bit bizarre, I have to say. And I kind of like, what are you doing, mate? What's going on? So I said to him, like, seen this guy here? What do you think? He said, I'd phone the police. I went, oh, but he hasn't done anything wrong. And the guy's still there, by the way. And he hasn't done anything wrong now, has he? And he went, well, tell you what, I'm going to walk my dog round that way and go round through the cemetery, top of the cemetery, and go out through the other gate from the cemetery into the park. And he goes, I'm going to walk back that way towards where we were and this guy is. I'll walk back through and I might scare him off. I did think, you ain't scared of no one, mate. Your spandex is a little bit strange, but you know, you're a little fella with a little tiny dog. You ain't going to do nothing, are you? But I did the wrong thing. I said, okay, mate, okay, right. Well, I said, the dog wants to get off anyway. And we were going the other way. We were going to head down to Liscard and the Royal Oak, which is what we did. So I left this guy to do all that. Goes against all of my nature, by the way. Ordinarily, I should have roared at this guy, what the fuck are you doing? Hey, you fucker. And you say, like, but you can't, you pedo, what are you doing? Which will put the fear of God into anybody, obviously. But I had no proof of this. He could have had problems. And maybe I was scaring him and agitating him. So I was going through all this fucking confusion. So we leave the cemetery and we end up down the Royal Oak. And a lot of my mates are in there. And I said, I've just had this thing there. Every single person should have phoned 999. And I felt so stupid. Oh my God, yeah, I should have. Why didn't I do that? Why didn't I do that? So, well, why don't you phone 101 now? I even got in touch with my wife, Mrs. Kilt-Man, who was working in Chester at the time, and I said, like, oh, this fucking thing's happened here. What do you think I should do? Because it's now at least half an hour ago, and so we phone the police now. You won't even be there, probably. And she spoke to some of her mates in the office, and they went, should have phoned 999. And she had, like, phone 999 now. But I still undernard. But I phoned the 101 number instead. Oh, big mistake. The 101 number for non-emergencies. But it's the police. You would think that they've got enough people there to pick up the call. Just because it's not a life-threatening emergency, it could still be something pretty bad. There's 20 guys just gone in with sledgehammers into a shopping mall, which is what's happening now all the time because no one can police shoplifting anymore. So, I've just seen this. There's 20 guys masked with sledgehammers and machetes. Well, that's more 999, isn't it? Now I've just said it out loud. That's kind of like, yeah, that's an emergency. But I had this conundrum, like, and I'm not normally like that. I also not when really like, I don't normally like to use the police. Because I can normally sort things out myself. Which is another thing why this has bothered me so much. Because I didn't do it properly at all. I think having the dog was a major thing. And that's not going back to the other dog issue. Because Roxy wouldn't have been that, but she wouldn't have bothered with him at all. She's like, hello. Lick, lick, lick. Hello, you got your treats in your pockets for me? When I'm fucking patching this guy to bits tonight. But, so I sat down with the dog and I phoned 101 and you got through to, this is police, an automated thing. Press this, then press that. And a good 15 minutes of waiting, going through all this bullshit and listening to like the recorded messages. You can go online, you can report the incidents online. Be quick about these things. Oh, look, if it's not that major, it's just an ongoing thing. It's just something you've spotted. Go online. But otherwise, just press this button now. And like, it's not an emergency, but you still want someone to speak to you pretty quickly. You'd be fucking phoning it otherwise, would you? So 15 minutes at least to get through to like, an operator will now take your call. Another 10 minutes waiting. Fucking threw the phone down. Fuck that. Police station's around the corner. Right, come on, Roxy. One more whiskey. And then we went into the police station and we sat there with a lovely female police officer and explained the whole thing. And I showed her my pictures of this guy. I'd even, done that little squiggle on your phone, your thumbnail, your nail, and just make a little mark. I said, that's the guy there. I said, but you won't see a damn thing because it's like pictures of Loch Ness Monster or Bigfoot. You can't see it. The trees and the railings just obscured the whole thing. But I gave a perfect description of the guy, and he said, we'll send someone around. Don't worry, we're going to send someone around. And I said to him, like, so in future, if I think there's something dodgy going on, what do I phone? She went, in this incident, you phone 999. So folks, this is a word to the wise. You might not think that that's a life-threatening scenario, but it could be. What if that guy had then got a knife out and attacked people in that kids' play area? It happened in Lyon in France only a couple of months ago, where that guy went ballistic and, bladistic, and started stabbing babies and kids in pushchairs. Well, like I said, I'm coming here now because it's on my conscience now that I waited too long. And she said, well, nothing has been reported, so don't worry about it. But we're going to send someone round now, and they'll have a look. And I was going, like, well, in future, if I see something like that, what do I do? Do I phone 999? And she went, yes, you do. And I say, well, what do I say to them to make them immediately aware that this is not immediately life-threatening, but it's actually could be really serious. Just tell them straight. There's a man. I know this is a wake up call for me. I've dealt with police, military, and a lot of civil unrest and many, many military situations in my time. And I prided myself on the fact that I know what to do in any situation. A riot, a mob attack, a bomb going off, an explosion by gas or other means, buildings coming down, earthquakes. I kind of know what to do. And yet, in this incident, I'm getting older. Maybe I'm getting some kind of fucking dementia or Alzheimer's, but I acted really out of character. And that's really done my head in, because if something had happened, you wouldn't see no more videos of me. I would have probably, if something had happened in that play area and I had the power to have stopped it and I didn't, I procrastinated and I just was hesitant and didn't know what the fuck I was doing. What number do I affirm? What do I affirm? Can I get over that? I've gone over fucking all sorts of things and took people down who were about to do stuff in the past. Why did I think, not once, not twice, not three times, but many times over this, and and ah, not half bother me. It's not half bother me. I haven't seen him since, hasten to add. Right, anyway, that was the weirdo in the park. Good friends, you can message me about this because we can talk a bit more in depth. Writing letters. Who writes a letter anymore? Does anyone write letters anymore? Actually, the art of writing a letter. Dear Jonesy, how are you? Did the alien get you? Did you survive in the Narcissus shuttlecraft? Writing letters, receiving letters. I don't mean printed out things. Someone has took the time to take quill to paper and scribe, you know, with calligraphy, a message to you, a letter, a story, a whatever to you. When's the last time you got one? Yeah, you don't get them, do you? There was a time when, like, you had pen pals and stuff, like, or family, and you'd write to them, how are you doing? Oh, what's going on? We've been doing this, paragraph, 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 you know, and you'd write. Sometimes lined paper, sometimes, if you were really good, like my daughter, you can just write. God, she could write on a pavement and it would be just absolutely, it would be pristine, be amazing. And but when was the last time you did it? And would you appreciate a letter now? It's weird. This thing came up, you see, I saw it the day and I'm like, do people write letters anymore? And it's a lost art, is it not? You've seen me, my notes for this, I can't read half of them because I can't write anymore. The last time, I mean, I've written books and I used to write my notes and my first treatments of a book, my first draft, longhand on paper, biro. And it was be joined up writing, you know, double letters, you know, like that. And you come back to read it and I could read it, it was legible. I knew how to do all the stuff, like the little curves and the little eyes, and you could do it. It was, I write very small as well, so but I could still do it, and I write small and very quickly. I speak very quickly as well, you may have noticed, and but I could read that. But in the years, and it's a good few years of just computers and emails and on your phone, texts and messenger, you know, and, oh, get rid of that predictive fucking text. That's a fucking nightmare, that is. But I can't write anymore. My handwriting is utterly deplorable. I cannot read it. And it's hard to physically do it, to hold a pen. And because of these videos, I do sometimes with the magazine ones, I write notes. So I'm not like I'm not used to it. I haven't done it for years. I did it the other week. But again, I've struggled every time. If I could show you the writing, it's so, well, the ring light's gonna warp it all out. Nah, don't bother. Another idea gone to rack and ruin there. I can't do it. I cannot physically write. I'm not sure where to hold the pen. And I'll do the first few letters kind of big, and then it goes, You've been choked halfway through writing your first word, and then every other subsequent word is like, and you just go, oh, fuck it, I'll read that later. You look at it, you go, I've got no idea what the hell that says. What is that shit? You know, it's just complete and utter bollocks. And I've just realised that I'm going to have to cut this massively short very, very soon. I've really missed time this one. I knew this was going to be a problem, this video, but anyway, and I've talked loads about certain things. But letter writing. What's the last letter you received that someone wrote to you? What's the last letter that you wrote? And because if you write something, it is, you're taking your time to write it. So you've got to remember, you get that letter from someone, you go, oh, they sat and they composed this and thought about it, put the thoughts down on paper, and then sent it to me. That took up a fair bit of their time. An email, a text message, it's fuck all. Absolutely fuck all. You know, so it's just an immediate, it's obviously more in keeping with the fast pace of life these days, but letter writing, it's a lost art. I'm not saying I'm going to go back to it. I've got no one to write to. Cheers, y'all. Right, okay. Okay, I think we've actually done everything. Yeah. No. There's a couple of the regulars. PEEVE of the week. Have you seen the confused.com advert? They caught you out. Confused.com. Oh, I hate them. Hate them. Hate them. One of the latest ones, and I meant to mention this about three or four magazine editions ago, but I didn't. Someone else took over. Another PEEVE was more PEEVE-y. This has been back on again today, and I saw it, and I fucking wanted to punch my fist through the fucking big screen. And it's the confused.com advert. And this is one that's, it's a gladiatorial arena. It's Gladiator. It's Maximus. And, well, it's not Maximus, but it's an arena. And it's all CGI crowds. It looks very good, actually. It looks very like Gladiator. Cheers, y'all. And there's a victory takes place. And you have, well, this is what pisses me off. You have an empress. Rome never had an empress. Had emperors, it had male rulers. There was never a female emperor, empress, ever. And you have this regal Roman noble woman who's in charge, and this guy gets put down in the arena, and like, and they all look to her, is it gonna be thumbs up, thumbs down? And she's like thinking about it, but she's got like a canopy above it in the blazing Roman sunshine. And above her is a, is it a squirrel or a marmoth? It's something like that. It's one of them fucking rodenty things. Arboreal rodents. And it's got like a peanut or something like, and it's going like that, eating it. And crumbs fall through the cracks in this canopy. And they land on her and she goes, this is the Empress. And she goes, like that, wiping the crumbs off. And all the crowd then go, they confused that with that, so they all start doing this, so that this guy gets booted into this fucking thing, like he starts playing the confused.com theme on his guitar. Fuck off. Commercials, I fucking hate them anyway, but this is ridiculous, because this again is the new world, the new woke order. Oh really, this is the Roman theater of games, the Roman Colosseum. You've got gladiators there who are fighting, and you've got a female empress? Didn't exist. There was none. So even in a fucking advert, you're rewriting history again. You're just, that just a subconscious thing to kids. Oh, obviously women were in charge of Rome as well. They never fucking were. They weren't. You could have had a bloke sitting there, but you did it on purpose to have a woman in there. Fuck off. You've got scrat above there from the Ice Age going, ee, little crumbs. And then she goes, and you'll go, fucking bollocks, mate. Fucking bollocks. That thing about the pressed thumb, No historians ever got this right, because no one ever knows what to show. Like, let them live. It was shown with pressed thumb. A pressed thumb could be like, or it could be downwards, or it could be upwards. Which one means let them live, and which one means kill them? By the way, it didn't happen very often. A lot of gladiators were not killed because they were such a huge commodity to be, you know, you invested money in them, didn't want them dead. So let them fight again. Just kill the Christians instead, like, that's easy, you know. Set the XL bully dogs on them, you know, that's what they do. But, so this fucking thing, that's annoying. Although we're kind of like, well, okay, no one ever knew what that meant. It's just our interpretation of it. But, so they've interpreted that as, oh, okay, that's how clapping came to be. Isn't that clever? What's that bitch doing there, sitting in the emperor's seat? Well, she's not the fucking emperor or empress, because they didn't exist. That's the peeve of the week. I fucking hate that. I hate that. That's little surreptitious wokeisms just thrown in to advertising campaigns. And like, oh, but it changes people's perceptions. New generations will watch that and go, well, obviously there were women there. Because apparently we have black princesses in the UK during the 14th, the 15th and 16th centuries. No, we didn't. We didn't. And they're teaching that in school now. They didn't. They were not black princesses. Oh, Kilt-Man, you're racist. I'm not fucking racist. I'm realist. They didn't happen. They didn't exist. Why rewrite history? Fuck off. Right, okay. Said I'd be quick, didn't I? I've blown that one. The earworm of the week. Just one second, folks. Just one second. You want to get some food now? No. Christ. Hang on. I'm in trouble. This has gone too long. EARWORM of the week, right? Let's quickly do this. And wouldn't this be the irony if I played this and after doing all this and getting bollocked by the family, that the whole thing gets blocked because I play this? Where the hell is it? This is Peter Best's score for Crocodile Dundee. This is tremendous, this. It's so cool, so meditative, hypnotic, and beautiful. Ordinarily, I talk at length about how we composed it and the instruments used, but I haven't got time. We're just gonna play the damn thing. Very Aboriginal, very Aussie, very ethnic, very rhythmic, very cool. And it's Mick Dundee at the end. He's in New York. He's going to go walk about, but he realizes that Linda Kozlowski is too fucking gorgeous to let go. No, hang on, the other way. He's gone walk about, and Linda Kozlowski, who's too fucking gorgeous to let go, realizes, nope, I'm going after him. And she runs down to the New York subway. And they will meet. There's all the heads. The platform is jam-packed. A mix down there. And she can't get through and she starts shouting, you know, I've got a message for that guy down there in the black hat. Tell him, I'm not going to marry Richard. And she's passing the message down to two other guys, a construction worker and a big black dude. And I go, I've got a message for the guy in the hat. Hey, you in the hat. You know, he's sort of like, what? Yeah. I've got a lady down here with a message for you. What does she want? Tell him, I'm not going to marry Richard. And they go, I'm not going to marry Richard. And the guy goes like, I'm not going to marry Richard. And he goes, why not? I don't know. And the message gets spread, why not? And then all the crowd are getting interested. Why not? Because I love you. And the guy's going like, she loves you, she loves you. And it passed the other guy and he goes like, because I love you, I love you. And Mick Dundee's like that. You know, Paul Hogan, he's just like, tell her, I'll tell him myself, I'm coming over. And he climbs up onto everybody's heads and shoulders. And to be honest, it would piss you off, would it not? Oh, you've got the crowd surfing bullshit and all that, but some guy walking on your head, you know. It's a crowd-pleasing moment of love being manifested. Why are you going to like let some guy put his fucking big Aussie cowboy boot on your head, you know? But he does it, and he's walking across. All the way to get it. And of course, when he gets there, it's a big euphoria, and the whole crowd fucking are uplifted. And the two guys that were relaying the message, he's like giving them fucking handshake and all that. It's brilliant. Brilliant. Croc Dundee is a fabulous movie. Crocodile Dundee 2 is an action movie, which is, it's more like fucking First Blood. But it's so dreamy and relentless. Linda Kozlowski. They've been married, weren't they, in real life? Although I think they've got divorced since. That's the movie industry for you. But fucking hell, she was unbelievably gorgeous. You've got like the croc goes for it. And she's got the little tiny thong on. And her camera gets the camera and she's like, ah! And he leaps up and he skewers it with his big Crocodile Dundee Bowie knife, which I've got somewhere here. No, I haven't. I've got very similar Bowie knives. That's everyone like, yeah. I love you, and all that. You've got all that going on. He skewers the head and twists it and kills the croc. And she goes, it was going to eat me. And he goes, oh, I wouldn't hold that against him. The thought crossed my mind. Because. Anyway, folks, I have been on with Shelby Kilt-Man. I have overran and caused trouble in the mansion. So please, in the meantime, this ever, snappy dog and alien body and massive floods and escape POWs. He's not a POW, is he? Not really. In between time. Please keep it cool, keep it kilted. I'm going to see you